Alors, nous allons commencer une session assez courte, puisque nous avons un petit peu moins d'une heure, pour parler de l'État arabe. Cette session est intitulée, alors je vais parler français, privilège de la francophonie, de la francophone dont c'est la langue maternelle. Cette dernière session est intitulée « The crisis of the Arab state is external intervention, the cause of the cure ». Je suis frappée depuis ce matin de voir qu'évidemment les États-Unis sont au centre de toute l'attention dans cette réflexion sur l'intervention extérieure. En tant que citoyenne d'une puissance intervenante de second rang et en tant que non-représentante de l'État français, je peux me poser de façon peut-être un peu différente cette question de la légitimité et de l'efficacité de l'intervention extérieure sur le fonctionnement interne des États de la région. Je vais juste vous citer trois points, trois questions que je me suis posées en regardant les thématiques que nous allons discuter dans cette table ronde. On parle dans le résumé de « The current degeneration of the Arab state ». Et je me suis demandé historiquement de quand datait cette fameuse « degeneration of the Arab state », de quand date l'État arabe finalement, pour aller dans le sens de Joseph Maïla ce matin qui nous a incité à replacer cette réflexion, pas uniquement sur la période récente, avec les interventions post-Seconde Guerre mondiale, je dirais, on a évidemment, bien évidemment, tout le legs ottoman qu'il faut examiner sur la culture ou l'existence d'une non-culture de l'État dans ces pays arabes. Deuxième question, la crise de l'État est peut-être généralisée au Moyen-Orient, mais elle a des formes différentes. Est-ce que tous les États sont semblables? Je crois qu'aujourd'hui, il faut vraiment que nous entrions dans une discussion sur la différenciation des formes d'État. Et ma troisième question, c'est finalement, est-ce que toutes les puissances n'ont pas précisément une idée différente de l'État, implicitement, lorsqu'elles interviennent, pour la consolidation des États? J'ai bien écouté Michel Duclos tout à l'heure qui nous a répété que les Français sont très attachés à la permanence et à la consolidation des États au Moyen-Orient. Nous avons eu beaucoup de discussions tout au long de l'année, dans cette période préélectorale en France, sur ce que signifiait la consolidation de l'État au Moyen-Orient, parce qu'on ne sait pas très bien de quel État les Français parlent. Chacun, finalement, soit projette son propre État à l'extérieur, soit projette un État qui correspond aux intérêts qu'il a envie de défendre. Or, aujourd'hui, quand les puissances extérieures interviennent au Moyen-Orient, elles le font sur une toile de dégénérescence de leur propre État. La crise de la démocratie dans les pays occidentaux est une réalité aujourd'hui, et elle affecte énormément notre réflexion sur les États arabes aujourd'hui. Pour ne pas voler le temps de parole des intervenants à qui on va donner 10 minutes, parce que je sais qu'ils vont les dépasser un petit peu, je vais leur donner la parole tout de suite. Chacun se présentera de façon plus élaborée que cela ne l'était donné dans le programme, mais je donne immédiatement la parole à Alberto Fernandez, qui est donc le vice-président du Middle East Media Research Institute et qui nous vient de Washington.
Shukran jazilan li hadhihi al-fursa an ahki ma'akum. شكراً لبيت المستقبل ولفخامة الرئيس جميل لهذه الدعوة اللطيفة. أنا أعتقد هلا سأحكي بالإنجليزي لبقية الكلمات. It's great to be here and to talk. We all have the misfortune on this panel of being at the deadliest time of day. We've all had a wonderful lunch. We've all had dessert. I had some wonderful Lebanese wine. And so this is the deadly time of day when we might fall asleep if our speakers are boring. I'm going to try not to be boring, to be very precise. You know, the introduction to this panel talks about whether external intervention is the curse or the cause or the cure. I think it is emblematic of the crisis and the problem in the region that we ask the question about whether it is the cause or whether it is the cure. The reality, the fact is, of course, that Western intervention, foreign intervention, has never been the cause nor the cure to the ills of the region. Certainly, there have been elements in history where events have happened or things have happened which have led to developments in politics because of foreign intervention. The state of Lebanon exists because of foreign intervention. So does Iraq, so does Jordan, so does Syria. The reason that people in Turkey speak Turkish is because people from Turkey left Central Asia and came to Anatolia and changed the demographics there. So of course, the history of the world is the history of foreign intervention. And yet, if we look at the region today, we know that, if we're honest, we know this, and we see this so often in the third world, that the problems of the region are deeply and essentially linked to the reality of the region. Foreign players can affect and move things in certain directions, but like other parts of the world, the essential step that has to be taken is the realization of people in the region that they are the authors of their own calamity and the author of their own crises that they face. This has happened in other parts of the world. This has happened in Latin America. And I hope that it will happen in the Middle East as well. When we look at Western intervention, I've heard some of the panels today. I like to break it down into three parts because I think we often combine things that are very different. If we look at foreign intervention in the Middle East, certainly there was a certain paradigm, a certain reality that existed from the post-war period up until the collapse of the Soviet Union, until 1991. It was the Middle East as part of an East-West conflict between the West and the Soviet Union and its allies, a conflict that was played out worldwide, not just in Hadhol al-Masakin fi Sharq al-Awsat, but it was played out in Latin America and even in Western Europe as well. It was an ideological, political, military, and economic struggle that went on. That phase ended, and we may remember in 1991 with the collapse of the Soviet Union, the great euphoria that there was that this was the end of history and that it was clear the way the world was going to be. The world was going to be about liberal democracy, it was going to be about free markets and free movements of people and a kind of a mutually accepted litany of human rights and other issues. This period of Western triumphalism ran from roughly 1991, and I cut it off with, if I needed to pick an event that happened in the Middle East, with the triumph of foreign intervention in Libya. That 20-year period is the period which, of course, encompasses such things as the war in Iraq, when the West particularly felt that it had the right and the vision and the ability to remake the region, to make the region better and different, and to be frank, to remake it into the image of the West. This is the year, these are the years of the Greater Middle East Project. This is the years of the democracy agenda of the Bush administration. These are years when the West, and principally the United States, felt that it could do a lot in the region, and that budgets were unlimited and abilities were unlimited to bring about change. That period has now ended. This change began in the Obama administration, and particularly marked with the first war or the first great political change of the new dispensation, which are both the Arab Spring, which is right at that period, and the war in Syria. These are dramatic, important political events that happened in the region without the leading role played by the West, without a leading role played by the by foreign intervention. Yes, there's foreign intervention. Yes, there are actions taken by the West, but they're primarily things that come from within the region. And we're still living in that stage today. I think that we see now that the nature of Western intervention is going to change. The period of open-ended, expensive, and ambitious, this conference is about the limits of ambition. Ambition has died. Ambition died in the reconstruction of Iraq. Ambition died in the price that was paid by the United States and by the Western Alliance in blood and treasure in Iraq and Afghanistan and in other places. So that ambition is gone. We now live in an era of limits, where not only the nation state is being challenged in the Arab world in a way that is very powerful and very dramatic, but the concept of the nation state is being challenged worldwide. So the West, like the East, like others, are looking at things that they can do which are high impact, high benefit, low cost. We are indeed in the era of the quick fix, and now we have an American administration which I think will be on the plus side, much more aggressive in seizing opportunities that exist in the region than the Obama administration was. I think there will be one that will focus on those priority issues for the West and for the United States. Number one, the destruction of the Islamic State. Number two, finding practical, real ways to confront Iranian regional ambitions in the Middle East. And number three, something I think which is unique with this administration and that you're going to see, is to try to find a way to address the ideological dimension of the struggle and the fight that's going on in the region. These are things that can be done aggressively. These are things that can be done dramatically. But they're not things that have an open-ended commitment, nor which have necessarily a very high and expensive price attached to them. I think two recent events are emblematic of this approach, of the approach that you're going to see with an American administration, which I think is going to be actually more forward-leaning than others in the region. Two recent events that we saw, one that had to do with the Europeans and one that had to do with the Americans. In recent months, you had the European Union sign agreements with the government of Sudan and with tribes in Libya to try to address the mass uncontrolled immigration problem. And then you had much more dramatically, much more famously, the April 2017 U.S. Tomahawk missile strike on a Syrian air base not too far from here. Both of these events were narrow, focused, practical steps taken by governments to try to solve immediate problems. They were not about the big picture. They were not about massive change. The deals made in the Libyan desert and the deals made with Omar al-Bashir about stopping an immediate problem, which is people leaving Africa and drowning in the Mediterranean trying to get to Europe. The American intervention in Syria was not about overthrowing Bashar al-Assad. It was about taking one thing which could be taken off the table and removing it, which was the use of chemical weapons. This is the paradigm, I think, of Western intervention. I leave Russia aside because Russia is a different case, but this is the paradigm of Western intervention in the Middle East going forward. The previous administration, the administration of President Obama, which I disagreed with on many things, revealingly though, said a couple of things which I think are were precursors of where we are headed in the region. One of the president's most senior advisors, Benjamin Rhodes, a senior advisor to the president, very famous or infamous, depending on your point of view, said in late 2015, he said, it is not the role of the government of the United States to fix fundamentally broken societies in the Middle East. Such a statement, such a bold statement, some might even say such a bigoted or even a racist statement, were said in other ways by the Obama administration. And I think even though this administration is going to be much more forward-leaning in traditional ways of working with our allies, reforming traditional alliances, I think the same idea of the cost of overreach, the cost of imperial overreach, the realization that the crises in the Middle East are greater in degree but not so much different than crises that are happening in Western Europe or in the United States or in other parts of the world, mean that Western governments are going to avoid an overinvestment and an overemphasis on the region as much as they can. I think, to close, with a couple of caveats. As much as the West would like to stay away from the region, I think there are two things that are always going to draw them in and two things that are always going to be a challenge, and they're problematic. Number one, what we've seen already, is, of course, the grotesque types of human rights abuses which cannot be ignored. Now, some of you will say Syria, and why hasn't the West intervened in Syria? I would say that you have human rights abuses where the West can intervene easily, and the West will continue to do so. When you have Muammar al-Gaddafi, a dictator saying, Zenga, Zenga, I'm going to go from house to house in Benghazi and kill everyone. And you know that he's weak. And you know that he is relatively easily removed. That is a provocation that Western powers that want to do something will be able to do. So the power to shock, the power of human rights abuses to mobilize the West will still remain, but that is not an open-ended thing as we've seen in Syria and in other places. This is always mediated, it always depends on the circumstances. The other situation, special situation where you could see Western, a greater emphasis on Western intervention or Western action is the implosion of nation states, where a real vacuum is created which allows all kinds of bad actors to do things, as we've seen, whether it has to do with immigration, whether it has to do with terrorism, as happened in Iraq. I was in the Obama administration, and the Obama administration had no interest whatsoever in returning to Iraq. It was forced to do so because of a human rights calamity, because of terrorist success, and because of the weakening of a nation state. Those three things together forced a reluctant administration's hand and moved it to take action. So that's where we are. The West is going to continue to have an interest in the region, but it is going to be reluctant to do so. And it will only seek to take action in ways that have a high cost-benefit analysis that benefit Western countries without a tremendous cost. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Alberto, for this very focused, policy-oriented, and short intervention. And then I leave the floor to Lais Kuba, who comes from the National Endowment for Democracy in Washington.
Thank you very much. شكرا جزيلا. أحب أبدأ طبعا بتقديم الشكر فخامة الرئيس جميل أسرة بيت الحكمة كونراد أدنور على هذه الفرصة الطيبة وعلى بيت المستقبل وكونراد أدنور على هذه الفرصة الطيبة. طبعا أحب اسمحوا لي أن يكون حديثي باللغة الإنجليزية للسهولة وللسرعة. راح غيرت بعض طبعا النقاط اللي كنت ناوي أعرضها لأن أحب أبني على الرؤى الجميلة اللي ذكرت في بداية الحديث وأفصل في المساحة اللي أنا مختص فيها. Before I start, I need to make maybe three disclaimers. One, that my views are my views. They do not represent the organization. And number two, that my work at NED over the last 19 years, which is basically some in providing assistance into over 200, 300 groups in the Middle East. I've resigned my position last week, so I can, that's a second disclaimer. And the third disclaimer I need to make is that, forgive me if I'm not politically correct in addressing this subject, because I do believe based on the avoidance of the debate this morning, I feel we will be wasting our time if we do not talk direct and address issues. Based on that, I want to focus my remarks on the politics of the intervention at the other end of the spectrum, i.e. amongst Arab societies, what are the politics of intervention? The reason I'm qualified to speak on that subject, a part of my background, for a good 30 plus years, I was in exile, actively opposing the regime of Saddam Hussein, mobilizing media, mobilizing support after the chemical attacks in Halabja, after invading Kuwait, after what happened in North Iraq, helped in various projects. So I was active doing things, what quote unquote seems to be against my country, and I have to sell that idea. Why do we need to call for support from the international community and on what? For 1 year, I was in the Iraqi government in 2005 after it was after its first election, and we worked, I worked as part of the government with Prime Minister Jaafari hand in hand, and we needed the American presence. Also, they were occupiers, but they were needed. And I think, as I said, in the last nearly 20 years, I worked at the National Endowment for Democracy, where we had a budget, and we more or less go and help projects in various countries that are to do with building civil societies, empowering voices, trying to push for better governance. And there is a lot of politics involved in all that. And wherever you go, you will see some people who will label you as a traitor, as an agent, as somebody who is destroying one's country or leading to its divisions. And on the other hand, you'll have people from your own country, patriots, absolutely asking you to go and raise their voices and lobby for them and do that work. And you do a lot of soul searching to say, what is the compass? What is the right balance? It's an imperfect world. Intervention is everywhere. We're kidding ourselves if we assume there is no influence, no intervention, no agendas, nothing is political. Everything is about intervention and influence and assistance sometimes. Where I stand and my politics over the years has been not all influence and intervention, foreign influence and intervention, not all of it is bad. There is what is clear black, let's call it bad, invasion, occupation, annexation, absolutely, no way. And I've resisted that throughout my life. And there is at the other end of the spectrum, which is white, definitely constructive, be it assistance to build the economy, infrastructure, or even interventions through fighting terrorism or fighting illicit networks, or if there is a humanitarian crisis, and there are a set of other causes. And I think the most difficult one, the political one, is the gray area. What do you do about intervention if it's a bit in the gray area, when money seeps in and influences elections, when it influences media organizations, when it influences all sorts of areas, covert and indirect? Where do you classify that, and where would you draw the line? And I think that gray area is now in everywhere. The Northern Star that guides my thoughts on this is that when we, I think previous presenters highlighted that intervention is often caused by internal failures, when governments fail to deliver either security or sovereignty, or when they become a cause for immigration or a humanitarian crisis, then the interests of other countries call for intervention, be it through UN mechanisms or be it indirectly, i.e. through unilateral or collective decisions. I think the failure of addressing the root cause of the failure of the states need to be in question. And what I heard this morning and through the debate, maybe there are four concepts we need to touch on. One concept is the nation state and its sovereignty. I think all nation states need some mythical narrative to create that binding call to put all citizens together under one roof. And we all know in every single society, all societies are pluralist. They are multi-ethnic, multi-religious. All societies are, they have either historical or factual divisions. So the attempt to recreate nation states does not necessarily mean you're going to create peaceful states or more successful states. The root cause of the problem is bad governance. It is not the sovereignty of a nation state or the concept of a nation state. And I think, take for example, the Kurdish call today, and there is a lot of hope that they want to create a nation state, as if the answer is in a nation state. You create a nation state, but if it has bad governance, be sure it's going to break down into two or three states, and it's going to have all sorts of civil wars. And we've seen this over and over in so many places. If that analysis is right, and the root cause is bad governance and failure of state institutions to deliver to its citizens, to protect fundamental rights and community rights, and to provide for a productive economy with some form of representation and accountability. If that's what works and what makes citizens of all backgrounds and nationalities happy, then this should be the common ground that both Western governments, foreign governments, and different constituencies within every country should work towards. Now, is this an ideal common ground? Can it be shared? I would say in 80-90% of the cases it will. There is a vicious circle, some tyrannical regimes that absolutely resist reform in any form or shape, and they need pressure. And when pressure is put on them, they resist as much as they can, up to a point where their compromise and their survival is critical. So should we call for pressure on them? Absolutely. Should we use every possible venue to build and strengthen communities that call for reforms within these countries? Absolutely necessary. Those, in my view, as I said, over the years, I travel in various Arab countries, and I meet people, and a lot of people say, you're an American agent, you're working for a foreign agenda. True, all donor countries have their own agendas, but all donor countries have an interest in having stable regimes and functional productive regimes. I do not believe, maybe there is the odd government or two that has an agenda of breaking communities down and breaking state institutions and creating environments that are ripe for illicit networks, for terrorism, and for immigration. This is just too far-fetched. The reality is there is common ground and shared interests in pushing towards good governance. And definitely, if a government or a state fails to deliver, and if it is involved in humanitarian crisis or genocide or repression at a gross, massive scale, then sovereignty should not be that thin paper that tyrants hide behind in order to defend and preserve their position. Definitely, I think the what happened with Saddam's invasion of Kuwait, where the whole concept of sovereignty has been violated, and what happened initially when he bombed the Kurds with chemical weapons in the 80s, and the world, and he argued this, the Iraq argued that it does what it wants within its sovereign borders. This, luckily, is no longer the case, but I think what is needed more is a constructive vision, and definitely selling the politics of soft intervention, which I know more about than the hard intervention. Thank you.
I'm so happy that I have so many so disciplined speakers who are just taking exactly the 10 minutes that they've been allowed. So Hassan, I don't have to present you. It's your time.
Okay, I'm actually going. سوف أتكلم باللغة الإنجليزية لمتابعة الحوار كما ابتدأ. I'm going to speak in English in order to link into the to keep the conversation in the same idiom that has started. I actually very much so agree with Alberto on his periodization of the assessments of interventions, talking about, if you'd like, I would rephrase it a little bit. Okay, we have the Cold War. At the end of the Cold War, we have the optimistic globalization period, and then we have the more realistic today, which is effectively what he has said. However, I would inject into that the notion that we need to consider multiplicity of actors and not just the acting force and the state receiving the intervention. And this is where basically what the period of globalization has witnessed and helps us understand, helps us answer the question whether intervention can be a solution or a cause for problems. Part of those actors are the ones that actually Laith have alluded to and actually specifically referred to. There is in virtually everywhere on Earth today, not just as a result of globalization, but as an innate phenomenon, a civil society that may or may not be called civil society, that have an interest that is not in line with the state. Now, it so happens that the states in our region have to a large extent followed the model not of the nation state, but of the autocratic state that covers itself with notions of either dynasty or revolution. the so-called republics, which in fact are military republics. So effectively, the notion that these states would try to prevent foreign intervention in the form of support for civil society, as we have that example actually, not just in a place like Egypt that has resisted intensely through very restrictive legislative process in order to block it, but even in Iraq after the fall of the regime, which tried to canalize, to effectively box out any attempt at intervening with its civil society by even creating a ministry of civil society, which is almost a contradiction in terms. But the end result here is what we have in any assessment of how an intervention, what an intervention is to try to measure these multiple actors, civil society, but also, and here is where I think we have had a major regression. In the 90s, we gradually evolved in international law what we thought of as the right to protect, which exactly addressed the notion that Saddam cannot bomb Halabja and say it's my prerogative. Sovereignty is transcended, is bypassed by the right to protect, but then we even evolved it into the notion of the duty to protect. When there is outrageous acts against human rights, such as what happened in Rwanda, and what happened in Kosovo, we have the duty to protect as an international community. Clearly, very often, this principle of duty to protect was invoked after the fact, meaning it's retroactive, and therefore it's really actually fictional. And it proved to be so exactly in when each situation got to be perceived as such. And while Alberto would put the end of the second period at Libya, I would put it at Syria, because in Syria, we have effectively the American president, Barack Obama, making contradictory statements, first about how exceptional we are, and because we are exceptional, we ought to protect those who are in need of such protection, and then not do it. So here we have had the effectively the retreat from the second notion, the second period, the period in which the international community represented by international law had the duty to protect, and we reverted to a more on a case-by-case basis study of how to react to situations as they emerge, frankly, all the way with a full circle almost. If you look at it, let us look at it just in terms of the American administrations. We had with Bush the father, we have the attitude that we act on the basis of realism. We act where our interests, guided by our values, but our interests are challenged. It was the Clinton era that witnessed the evolution of interests first, value second, to the whole notion that interests and values, at least in theory, ought to go in sync. It was the George W. Bush era in which basically that was put, however clumsily, however imperfectly, without any, if you'd like, real thought about the aftermath, was put into action by saying, let us create the greater Middle East. However, let's keep in mind again that the notion of the greater Middle East was not solely an American notion. It was to a large extent driven by expatriates and exiles who lobbied for it and underlined the fact that basically the veneer of autocracy, once it falls, what you will have are societies ready for democracy. Iraq as Prussia of the Middle East, Iraq as the beginning of a domino effect of fall towards democracy. What we had, therefore, under Bush, under George W. Bush, we had values and interests, at least for a few years, and then we reverted to the notion of, okay, we keep the discourse of exceptionalism and we keep the discourse of values, but we gradually move back to realism and to interests. Under Obama, and especially with Syria onwards, what we have is we brandish the discourse as if we are really exceptional, but we really retreat completely. What we're witnessing under Trump so far is that a jettisoning of the discourse altogether and a policy that is based on assessments that may or may not include values, but do not pretend to, and therefore a return to realism. So that in terms of how it affects, what does it mean for the Middle East and the nation state in the Middle East, it means simply that what got jettisoned in the process is the expectation of support for civil society from the United States. Because that, at this point, even under Obama, there has been a major retreat in the claim for such support and on the intent for such support, but not even a claim does not persist today under Trump. And here comes the important role that Europe can assume in the next phase. So the US has retreated from the recognition of the multiplicity of players, of the multiplicity of actors in the region. Europe cannot, should not, ought not, cannot afford to have that distance. And therefore, here we have basically an opportunity for Europe, which I have to underline, the whole notion of if you like, the gradation of states from an autocratic state to a nation state to a state of its citizens, which is actually, unfortunately, still without an example in the region, but ultimately is what a genuine civil society that's based on human rights and based on individual human rights ought to be working for, that comes to the region from Europe, okay, even though the US can legitimately claim that the first example of such a manifestation was not the French Revolution, but the American Revolution. But nonetheless, it comes to the Middle East from Europe, and there was an assimilation in the Middle East of those values. We're not talking here about, as very often in a very caricaturish way is presented in the United States, such as what Rhodes had said. The notion that there's no exportation of values, there's the recognition that there are shared values. When we look at the history of the Middle East in the 19th century, in the history of Lebanon, let's not go far, there was many Ammiyat in Lebanon. What is Ammiyat? When there were revolutions, actually, in multiple locales in Lebanon. What is Ammiyat? It is communes. It's like Europe was witnessing a series of communes. That effect, actually, there was a ripple effect in values and in action up to here. When the nation-state system emerged after the First World War, there was no uproar all over the Middle East. No, do not impose on us this nation-state system, because there had already been an assimilation of it. What comes next is the failure to deliver that causes some regression, and multiple regressions, actually. But the notion that a state of its citizens or a state based on representative government is alien to the region and therefore let's leave the region with its own problems is really a notion that is not based on a careful reading of the historical reality. So what I'm saying that we are now in a situation where we can expect a positive impact of the return of American role in the region, and that was demonstrated in the case of Syria, very simply. Indeed, a strike, I completely agree with Mr. Ambassador, a strike is not a policy, but a strike from the United States forces everyone else to scramble for policy assessments and policy contingencies. And this is what happened. After the strike, actually, it is very often said that maybe Khan Shaykhun was a mistake, but maybe Khan Shaykhun was actually a precursor to an attack on what they call Matmar Idlib. Matmar meaning, how do we say, the waste dump of Idlib. The whole notion that Idlib is now kind of full of despicable people, so we're going to attack them. Khan Shaykhun might have been a kind of a pilot project of sorts. So the American reaction might not be policy. It is still not policy, and indeed, it's actually, it may not be able to be policy, but what it has forced the regime, forced Iran, and forced Russia to make room for an American role because the US is back. And that's actually of extreme importance in the region, but the US will not be back for civil society, and this is where Europe is needed. Thank you.
Okay, thanks a lot, Hassan. Altogether, I'm under the impression that all the speakers made a case for intervention, so I'd be quite interested to see how the audience reacts. So can I just ask you to introduce yourself before speaking, because I may not be able to do it in your place. Where's the microphone? It's coming. Yalla, coming.
Alfred Madi. Well, there is a good reason, one reason which is we never mentioned about the intervention of Russia in Syria. Yes, there was a vacuum that Obama created, but the real reason behind the Russians intervening is the gas in the region and their big interest in selling gas to Europe, and they don't want this line to continue. I think this was, although other reasons are also correct, but this is, I think, a major reason why Russia intervened and why they're putting a lot of emphasis on a certain area which has catering to the Alawite or the Christians in the region trying to protect them. The other point, any solution in the region, if they don't cater to the ethnic and religious minorities and the majority, I don't think there will be a solution in the region of that could exist for a much longer period. The majorities in any country where they rule, no matter what type of government is there, unless they look the aspiration of the minorities or where the minorities rule, like Saddam when he was ruling in Iraq or the Alawites ruling, unless they also treat the majorities in a different way, I don't think there will be a solution. De Gaulle have said in the 70s that the world is moving towards larger economic unities and smaller political unities. Doesn't mean you're going to create states based on ethnic or religion. But what do you do with the Kurds? What do you do with the Alawites? What's happening to the Christians in the region? The aspiration of these has to be taken care in any solution, even if the majorities are going to rule or a democracy. And I think what Mr. Kubba have said about the government is very interesting. But unless these aspirations are met, the government will not be created in such a way to cater to the needs of the people, which is being freedom, the social, economical, or any of these things. Thank you. And just one last point. I don't think the international intervention have been happening to help the people. They're being always, there's an alliance between the interest of the intervention and whoever, being dictators or not, whoever is in authority, and they want to stay in power. So this power struggle in the country and the interests of the superpowers always rule this area. They talk about the aspiration of the people, but they never attend to it. Thank you.
Merci beaucoup. Deux petites questions. Je dois dire que je n'arrive pas à acheter l'idée de 30 années pendant lesquelles il y a eu un concept d'intervention occidentale pour soutenir la démocratie, grosso modo. Et est-ce que vous ne croyez pas qu'il est plus réaliste de considérer qu'il y a eu la phase de l'ex-Yougoslavie, qui était relativement un succès, puis ensuite la phase de la surréaction de l'administration Bush aux attentats du 11 septembre, surréaction allant jusqu'à l'invasion folle de l'Irak, et puis après une autre phase de surréaction d'Obama à la surréaction de Bush et allant dans le sens inverse de l'inhibition devant le recours à la force. Et alors, ça c'est la première question, est-ce que c'est pas plutôt ça la réalité des choses? Et la deuxième question, c'est est-ce que dans ce contexte, il est possible de revenir à un débat plus raisonnable entre occidentaux, mais éventuellement maintenant avec les Russes, parce qu'eux aussi sont partis dans l'aventure. Donc est-ce qu'il n'est pas possible d'avoir un débat réaliste sur ce que seraient les vrais critères de succès, de légitimité, de bien fondé, d'objectif, d'encadrement du recours à la force ?
Je pense qu'on a encore deux questions là devant.
Yes. The two questions. The first one is for everyone on the panel. Do they believe that the United States contributed to ISIS? The second question is mostly addressed to Mr. Fernandez. The United States, it's known that Israel is an ally to the US. Taking that into consideration, we understand that the US's approach to dealing with Iran and the proposition of Iran, what they would like to accomplish, is to weaken Iran. Would it be at any time much better to spend more effort in strengthening the Arab states, regardless of the alliance between Israel and the United States, instead of continuously looking to weaken Iran? And would it be even more interesting to take advantage of the current administration and to strengthen the Arab states within also the context of having peace in the Middle East with Israel, and therefore we wouldn't have basically the Iranian dream that we are all working so hard against, and we would have more peace in the region? Wouldn't that promote better United States interest also in the long run? Thank you.
لي تعليق سريع وسؤال. يعني الدول الكبرى، من يقرأ الأرشيف يعرف جيدا أنها تتدخل لمصالحها الاقتصادية، تصدير واستيراد والنفط خاصة. ثم المنطقة وشرق المتوسط بين آسيا وأوروبا وأفريقيا له موقع استراتيجي هام، قال نابليون لا سيري إلى كليدو لازي. ثم المنطقة مهد الأديان المسيحية والإسلام واليهودية. ألا تعتقدون أن إنشاء إسرائيل ونحن نحتفل هذا العام 100 عام على وعد بلفور، ليس فقط إنشائها على أرض فلسطين على حساب شعبها، وإنما التوسع والاستيطان وطرد الشعب الأصلي منها هو جوهر الصراع، وأن الحل على قاعدة القانون الدولي في هذه المنطقة هو الذي يخفف كثيرا من التطرف الديني وكل ما يتعلق بالعنف وما إليها؟ وشكرا.
On va donner 3 minutes each. Same order, Alberto.
Okay. First of all, on Israel, I would say that I think for the Arabs, if Israel didn't exist, the Arabs would have to create it, because it's the biggest excuse that is used in the Arab and in often in much of the Muslim world for whatever ails the Arab and Muslim world. I think that this is a grotesque exaggeration that exists. That is often used as a crutch for the problems of the region. I think if people want to look at the main factor for the problems of the region, they need to go find a mirror. That's the best advice I can give them. Did the United States contribute to the creation of ISIS? Of course. And so did the government of Iraq, and so did Salafi jihadism, and so did Ibn Taymiyyah, and so did, there are many, many factors, many, many players that led to the rise of the Islamic State. And when you talk about the United States and the Islamic State, or when you talk about Israel, remember that it was over 200 years ago that an army came out of Arabia and attacked the city of Karbala and put every man, woman, and child in 1801 to the sword. And this army, the writers, this is a Wahhabi army that came out in 1801, they described themselves as al-Muslimun. They were the Muslims, and the people that they were killing were the non-Muslims. So this idea of Salafi jihadism as a modern intervention, or as a result of the CIA, or of the Mossad, or of men from Mars, is a problem we face. As I said, the solutions of the region are to be found in the region, just like the disasters of the region have roots within the region itself.
Very quickly, I think I'll pick on two other points, and that is, no question donors or powers have their own agendas. not always their agendas are a bad thing. Today, Europe, the EU, really have an interest in having strong economies and stable countries in the Mediterranean, because that will stop the immigration problem, that will stop many, many other problems. So there is actually a shared interest sometimes in development, and some intervention and assistance is done with a win-win equation. I also don't live in a dream world. I know that the history says the default by just looking at memory and history, intervention has always been with colonialism or occupation or other forms. True, some of it exists today, possibly. Is what Russia and Iran doing deliberately trying to become hegemonic and expand their influence and have total disregard? Maybe. Shouldn't this be regulated? Definitely. But this is the reality of the world we live in, and I think the best one can do is to play its politics and strengthen the players so that you can maximize from your own perspective. Otherwise, you keep on judging it good or bad is not going to change the reality of it. Today, there is more intervention from within the region than there is from Europe or America. You look at Saudi Arabia, Iran, Syria, Iraq, you name it, Egypt and Libya. There is more intervention there. So, and maybe one other quick note, and that is on the issue of minorities and their aspirations. I totally agree, but I still make the distinctions. The real problem we had is with bad governance. I would not argue we need foreign influence to help us in nation building or constitutional development. And I don't believe that foreign influence or intervention will help fix existential problems. These problems have to be addressed very much from within, fully. But once they're done, you need help to build a state and an army and a bureaucracy, and that's okay. And I don't think national pride should be a problem in dealing with that, because that's part of the win-win.
Hassan.
Alors, Monsieur l'Ambassadeur, je comprends que ça a été 3 décennies d'action, mais c'était sûrement 30 ans ou presque, 25 ans peut-être, de penser en ce qui concerne un régime international qui serait favorable à des interventions en matière de droits de l'homme. Alors, ça a été mal appliqué, et je crois que l'intervention américaine en Irak a terminé cette expérience. De ce côté-là, je crois que ça a persisté quand même au niveau du discours aux États-Unis. Et avec Obama, ça a rétréci. Et avec Trump, aujourd'hui, ça disparaît. C'est juste ça. Mais ça n'a jamais été 3 décennies d'application, pour sûr. فيما يتعلق بمصالح الدول الكبرى. أستاذي عصام خليفي. فيما يتعلق بمصالح الدول الكبرى, لا شك بأن الدول الكبرى, لا بل والدول الصغرى, لا بل جميع العاملين, سواء كانوا دول أو مؤسسات أو أشخاص, ينطلقون من المصالح. ولكن هناك علاقة جدلية دائمة بين المصالح والمبادئ. وأستطيع أن أقول نتيجة متابعة حسية مستمرة للواقع الأمريكي بأن الجمهور الأمريكي, بأن الثقافة الأمريكية تطالب بأن تنسجم المصالح مع المبادئ, وترفض عندما يكون هناك تحرك على مستوى المصالح لا يتفق مع المبادئ. إذن سواء كان السياسي في الولايات المتحدة أخلاقيا أم لم يكن, هذا شأن ليس له أهمية على الإطلاق. الأهمية تكمن في أن الناخب يطالب بالمبدأ بالإضافة إلى المصلحة, وبالتالي على السياسي, على المنتخب أن ينفذ. وهكذا يجري. عندما تتدخل الولايات المتحدة لمساعدة المساكين في هايتي بعد زلزال خطير, كانت التحليلات هنا في الشرق الأوسط أنها تسعى لإقامة قاعدة في هايتي. لم يكن الأمر كذلك. هذا التدخل جاء نتيجة إصرار ثقافي اجتماعي على مستوى المواطن الأمريكي بأنه يتوقع وينتظر من الحكومة الأمريكية أن تكون مرآة لأخلاقيته. وأخلاقيته هي بأنه طالما أن هناك طرف مظلوم فعليها أن تساعد. ومن هنا أريد أن أتطرق إلى موضوع إسرائيل. علينا أن ندرك تماماً بأن إسرائيل من وجهة نظر اجتماعية أمريكية، إسرائيل على حق، إسرائيل مظلومة. إذن التدخل الأمريكي لمصلحة إسرائيل ليس لأن إسرائيل تشكل مصلحة أمريكية، بل لأن إسرائيل تنسجم مع هذا المجتمع على المستوى الأخلاقي وعلى مستوى القيم. إذا كان هناك ثمة تباعد، أي إذا كان هناك ثمة خطأ في هذه الصورة، فالمسؤولية تقع على الطرف الآخر أن يبين هذا الخطأ، وهذا الطرف الآخر وأقصد بذلك المضطهد الفلسطيني والمساهم بالاضطهاد العربي، ولاحظ بأنني أميز بين الاثنين، عليه أن لا يدعم قتل الأبرياء وأن يسميه مقاومة، لأن هذا يخلط الأوراق بالنسبة للمتابع الأمريكي، ويرى بأن صاحبة الحق أي إسرائيل يقابلها صاحب ظلم هو الجانب الآخر، وبالتالي لا يستطيع أن يوازي حتى في خطابه الاجتماعي والثقافي بالتأييد لإسرائيل والتأييد للقضية الفلسطينية. وهذه مسؤولية عربية أولاً، ولا أعتبرها مسؤولية فلسطينية، لأن الفلسطينيين في واقع احتلال. أما العربي الذي من خلف جهاز التلفزيون ينظر ويبتسم ويسعد لمقتل الأبرياء الإسرائيليين، فهو صاحب مسؤولية في هذا المجال.
Merci à tous. Il est 16h34. Je me tourne vers le président Jmaé pour savoir si nous avons rempli notre mission de poser les bases de ce débat sur la question de l'État en 55 minutes. Bravo. Et we'll see you again tomorrow, 10 a.m. sharp, to follow up with another debate on Russia in the Middle East. Thanks you to you all.